Welcome back, everybody, again to the Twitter Studio here in Berlin as we're doing our coverage of the MSI Beta 2014 Global Challenge. I'm your host for the English live stream, Toby One, bringing you our second game of our second series tonight, which is VP going up against Oslo Gaming. A full Russian affair is what we are doing this evening, and VP so far doing it in wonderful style, taking out game number one very, very convincingly. Never really looked like any of the lanes were even going wrong for them. There were a couple of interesting dives and moves, but apart from that, it still ends up with a very, very stable win for Virtus Pro and Hustler Gaming now. They're like, all right, well, you want to run Takiro Skywrath Mage? Let's see if we can run Takiro Skywrath Mage as well. So VP having their strats turned against them here. And then I'll see how they want to approach this game. They do have the Dire Sight advantage, which makes me wonder why they banned up the Lycan in the first set. Because it didn't have to be their ban, unless they just do not want to play a Lycan. But BZZ plays a very, very good Lycan. That's a little bit of a surprise. But they go Razor. We'll keep with Jotam's Mirana. That's one of his signature support heroes. So we'll assume it's going to be in a support role in this game as well. Radiant team back. With Skywrath as well as Jakiro. I like how VP now is like, yeah, we know what you're trying to do, Big Num. We know what you're trying to do. Bans the Earthshaker now to make sure they cannot run that Jakiro Skywrath Mage. Or if they are going to run it, it's not going to be with the greatest supports out there. Because it's the downside about doing a Jakiro Skywrath Mage. You're giving up all your stuns. So if you don't have any other heroes like Faceless Void, for example, to have a big chrono down, then you could have heroes like Weaver just run rampant all over you. And this is something which I'm wondering if VP are considering to do at the moment.
5 seconds remaining.
But VP still have their last set of bans, or the last ban here. Something up against the Razor. Well, let's take out the Ancient Apparition. All right, I'm fine with that. Radiant team ban. Razor's going to probably still try and get his mech up at a decent time. We'd laugh if Oslo Gaming's lineup actually worked and destroys VP. Because the offlaner, you're like, well, what am I supposed to run against this? Like, what are you supposed to run against this? You get harassed out from range, so you can't run heroes like Tidehunter. You can't run heroes like, why have you even banned Tidehunter? He doesn't work up against Jakiro and Skywrath Mage. He literally doesn't work. You get zoned out. So you can't run the Centaur either. So you need an offlane elusive hero or you need an aggro tri-lane. The dual lanes could work again. Like, if you can't just run a solo lane. If you run a Bane Mirana for the offlane for VP, then leave Razor on the top lane with somebody else who's got some nice control, you could probably go in for something like, well, would you want a Rubick in this game? Remaining. And you could do that. Or you could just say, like, a ban on the offlane. Just say, you know, screw it. We'll pick up something like, no, you still need some counter push. That's why I was thinking the Rubick. Time. Like, Doombringer's already been... Actually, no, Doombringer hasn't been touched. Doombringer could still be played here. VP could even get a little bit more greedy. Run the Razor in the mid, put the Doom on the top, and then run Mirana aggro trialing up against the Jackie Sky. That's another option for them. Huh. Maybe they didn't think really past denying the combination to Virtus Pro. That would be a bit of a rough position to be in, Big Num. I'd also love to if Virtus Pro just said, all right, we go Bear Dota. Like, let's just get the Ursa. Let's force out a level one engagement and fight on top of the Rosh Pit. That could be another way they look at it. They're definitely taking their sweet time. Yeah, they must not have thought about this. Unless they were considering running the Jakiro as a core and putting the ancient apparition in with the Skywrath Mage and going aggro tri-lane. Then they could start to kill with this lineup instead. I just love we're in a position though that people will pick Jakiro to block pick against Virtus Pro. It's like people who ban the Warlock against MVP. You just realize how much it doesn't work. We should go with another VS. So they did the VS in the last game. Wasn't really that successful, as the net worth was definitely proving. So they do actually have their stunner. They've actually technically got two stuns, because I know I said before, like, you give up your stun when you're a Jakiro, But of course, he went for your ice path, so it works. So you do have, you do technically have a setup stun to your follow up stun.
5 seconds.
But what made the last game work was the fact they got completely outlaned on everything, including the middle lane. Like that Ember versus the Lina was brilliant. It was actually brilliant. He harassed him so heavily in the early stage with just basic right click, that early null talisman with a couple of consumables, and you're good to go. And VP, looks like they're going to play a little bit more of a standard game here. They get the Death Prophet. That's good counter push. Mirana, who, when Ocelot Gaming pushed on the bottom lane, if Mirana's in a good position... oh, yes! Love it. But when you run an aggressive lane and you try and push that, Mirana can go to where the Ancients are and get an arrow straight through that tree line, and you might just get an early hit. And that may be enough, but a Pudge pickup here from Ocelot. Ocelot? I think it's actually meant to be Ocelot. It's meant to be Ocelot. I might be wrong. Because if it's Ocelot, it would actually be the other way around, where it's an IL instead of an LI. We went through this earlier today. I'm a lazy reader. There's our Bane from VP. All right, so it's going to be there's going to be a dual lane, off lane, or potential aggro tri lane with Bane, Mirana. They're guaranteed to be off lane here. There'll be a dual combo on the off lane. The Death Prophet will be fine up against the Pudge, and then the Razor can go towards the top lane. But depending on the last hero from Ocelot Gaming, depending on the off laner, they may decide to run the Death Prophet on the safe lane and put the Razor in the mid up against the Pudge. Because Razor obviously has the movement speed down, like hands down, over on we don't actually have it showing up here. I don't know the movement speed off by heart for Pudge and Razor, but Razor should be able to win on the movement speed over Pudge, which means he can keep that static link going and really do a lot of damage to Pudge early on. The Viper will be the final ban out. Another good solo hero could have worked on an aggro tri lane, because if this is a support Mirana with Bane, they're only there to set up for the stuns. And then they'll just keep rotating around. So yeah, a hero like a Viper would have been able to tank up and remain on the offlane while still get a couple of kills.
10 seconds
remaining. I've actually got a funny feeling we're going to be looking at something else like a Windranger in this lineup. It's a very high maneuverable hero who's got another couple of controls, but has burst damage of her own that will work with like Mirana and Bane. So this is kind of like where I would lean towards. Nature's Prophet, the final ban out from Ocelot Gaming, so removing the extra pushing power and the split pushing power, VP want to fight him like men. Front lines and undying? Okay.
Virtus pros, turn to pick.
All right. Screw the meta. Just throw that book out the window, you know? So, Pudge is a call, obviously. I say that. I saw a support Pudge 2 days ago. Never do that. That was horrendously done. But Pudge is a core. Undying and Jakiro could be the cores here. Remaining. But you could also sub Skywrath and VS, and people have been running Skywrath as a core as well.
5 seconds remaining.
So you could leave Jakiro to the offlane solo, to the safe lane solo, and run Undying VS Skywrath on aggro. So they put an Abaddon into this mix up. That's actually a core Mirana then. Jotam will be playing the Abaddon instead, and BZZ will take up the Mirana pickup. Yeah, I think they're really, really concerned about the aggressive tendencies that this lineup of Ocelot Gaming could have.
For battle.
All right, so what do we got? Core Skywrath. Core Skywrath with a whole lot of consumables. Running a Dendi-style Pudge. That's if Ink stays on this bottom lane. But the Skywrath Mage should be a mid-solo. We get an offlane Jakiro, who has Observer Wards, but it is I assume to be a core Undying. He's got a lot of consumables for this top lane. It's a Boots first Jakiro, and he didn't spend his money. Yeah, it's a core Jakiro with Undying support. We have a VS, who if BZZ can use the Fog of War nicely, can get a first blood here. But, yeah, he's in the trees and he can see the VS moving back. So, won't get first blood.
30 seconds
it's going to be a... Oh, wait, no, Skywrath is now on the bottom lane and Pudge has moved towards the mid lane. What the hell? Decide! Yeah, the reason why I said, like, a Dendi Pudge is because on the bottom lane, Dendi will run a Pudge that way where you just keep farming up. You get an early earn. You get your level 6. You get yourself back to base. Could be sent back by a Chen or whatever. In the normal times where it was Puppy playing Chen with Daddy running that kind of pudge. And you'd just like send him back to base.
Begins.
And he'd buy he could either buy his own TP and send himself back, but he'd get a smoke more importantly. That's like the key thing for this. Goes back, gets full health, gets full mana, and gets a smoke. Runs out and finds a kill straight away. Normally he heads towards the mid lane to do such a thing. So that's what I was referring to as far as like the Dendi punch move. Also, VP, they actually are running an aggro tri lane. An aggro tri lane with an Abaddon security. And they should actually be successful about this one because it's like Undying and Jakiro on the off lane. I'm not feeling the magic as much. And now Yol moves in. Nightmare, be careful about this. Yeah, actually he waited.
Yes.
So smart. So smart to wait for that one. This will be the BS dead on the bottom lane. Even though she triggered, was that a salve he just triggered of his own?
First blood.
It was the sound effect for it. I think he did. So first blood is spilt. Now, middle lane shouldn't be good for Pudge. God again has the advantage over DPS here. Because he's got Crypt Swarm Harassment. And just his base damage. 61 up against a 59. Like, if Pudge can land a hook, then he might better get on top. But as you're seeing right there, God with the early Null Talisman as well, he's just leading this as far as kills and harassment goes. And Ink can't use his Rot to farm up either. Because if he uses that, he gives too much away. Also notice too, it's now just the dual lane on the off lane. They get the first blood, so Bane and Morana are happy with things, and Abaddon will shift towards the top lane to help out Seedoy, because he really does need it. He's still going up against an Undying, who's a bit of a pain in the butt for stealing all those life points away from you. Yeah, but the thing on BZZ, by the way, he waited for the Nightmare to be taken by the Vengeful Spirit, because VS just assumed the arrow would fly at the Skywrath Mage, like he initially initiated on target. But he didn't. He waited for the switch. If he waited any longer, the initial Nightmare would have actually worn off and the gank would have failed, or he would have had to just go for a straight arrow without having the Bane Nightmare set up.
My wings. Let us fly.
Nice little DD rune up on the top. Razor. So she managed to find 6 for 2 on this lane. Very surprising. How's that Pudge looking? 7 for 0 up against a 12 for 2. Not too shabby with the new creep wave coming over. And Jakiro on the top lane, 8 for 1. It's not that great there. Morana, BZZ's managed to find himself almost a 9. Actually, yeah, it's an 8 for 2 for BZZ. So still keeping up with a little bit of the CS. But this VS Skywrath Mage. Are we going again, y'all? We can't. Like, the AWP harassment damage is going to BZZ. He's moving himself in the tree line. It's like, okay, if you're going to keep from abilities, like this Orb of Skywrath, he's just going to pick up a stick.
Is ours.
Better way to do it. It's like Big Nun will also intercept the creep wave over on the side. But Seedoy is still finding some levels, so this is okay for him. And Death Probe is up to 4 levels, Pudge. He's keeping up with the CS as well as the levels too. Let's just have a quick pause coming out. I don't know if that's because of... Okay, yeah. I got a funny feeling that... Okay, no, it's just a pure sorry. Because Yol is, at this point, sealed. So they got initiation on him. And actually, also like, decided to fall themselves back a little bit. Oh, they got shot him. I think he flied out the fact that Big Num's coming in from the side. Seedoy's already used his Static Link, and now, in fact, Dual Breath levels being used by Judo. Try and chase down Seedoy, but then the shield can just turn this one around. Liquid Fire, well, it can keep doing its burning. But the shield shall protect. Oh, we got in for God. A DD rune in his bottle, extra tango for regeneration, and a failed hook from the Pudge. It's also level 5, and you're seeing God. He's got boots already. And with the DD rune, he could force this. He needed one more hit in the Crypt Swarm, and he had the kill. Well, it was only a level 2 Crypt Swarm. That's why he needed the extra hit. What the hell? Oh, wait. That's, yeah. I'm like, that courier's got some serious stuff. Like, because... This is not aerodynamic. You got a blind driver... And excess baggage. No wonder he's a shitty wizard.
Denied.
He's definitely not an engineer. Alright, so this top lane, so the build's different for the Jakiro. He went for the dual breath instead, so he's looking for the double slow instead of using the ice path for the controlling ability. And Seedoy is actually quite okay with like having his life points slowly dripped away. It's also a bit of a downside. You could look at this and say, okay, difference between game one, game two. Seedoi, okay, be really, really careful. Chill Breath's going to slow him down. Chikiro's coming over, and there's the life points first, and shield potentially second. In fact, now shield should go up from Jotun. Seedoi, ah!
Radiant's top tower is under
he was trying to wait it out, and the shield just ends up triggering. Actually, no, he actually never triggered the shield. Yeah, but why it doesn't always work, just look at someone's combo, and then instantly pick it up in the next game. You gotta remember that they played that combo because they've trained that combination. So you can block pick it, but you can't expect you to have the same synergy as what's been in the enemy lineup. Okay, are they gonna find Big Number in the corner? They're not. Yeah, but you can't expect to have the same kind of synergy because you probably never would have practiced this combo yourself. So block picks are good to one point, but they can also cripple you if you're not used to playing it. Y'all's moving down looking for an opening. He's gonna find the VS. Okay, whoa. Okay, he might have to do a fish arrow here. Nightmare. Where's he's actually saving it. Brain sap already. The arrow is well off target. Nightmare's on the Skywrath Mage, and y'all on 9 life points gets away from this one. Skywrath will not be able to catch up to him, and y'all just TP's out. Schmutz. He realized the Skywrath was too far northwest to move back down to attack him. The orb attack was potentially there, but he'd also just used that as well. So even triggering a concussive shot at that point would have only just hit the nearest target. Which in that case, was not the Bane. It was the Mirana. And Mirana made the most out of it. Was able to just let the Starfall go. Get the easy kill on the Vengeful Spirit. And then return to lane. And with Krobalti as well, the Exorcism. TP onto the tower is coming from the Undying. But also at the same time, I get one decay off on God. But the lane switch-ups happen now. So Bane's getting the solo experience in the middle lane. It's a TP in from Jotun. And are they actually switching these lanes out? Or are they going to force the issue? There's four heroes from Ocelot Gaming on the bottom lane. And they're going to find at least one in the trees. Hits the stun. Crypt Swarm. And the Mirana Starfall finishes the job. The Exorcism was also still up. And if they really needed to, they could have thrown the nuke out from Jotun. But now they can... I don't know if they can really force this issue. They got one more bottle charge up on God, but I'm pretty sure God's going to hold on to his... onto his mana. They could do some harassment damage to the tower. Well, actually, God should be taking this, not BZZ, because he's got the bottle charge. BZZ! Yo. So they want this catapult to live, but they're going to realize they can't do it. Everything's back a little bit too far. Hey, punch and hook. And dismembered and killed off the Bane. Maybe a little bit too greedy. Over on the side, though, Visage. I mean, Visage. Skywrath Mage. They caught Winged Fiends. Skywrath Mage goes down. Looks like just an easy Mirana arrow and the shielding from Jotun. That wasn't actually as easy. Skywrath was most definitely looking to kill off BZZ just then. But the shield from Jotun just continues to protect. Undying's rotated back up towards that top lane now. And he'll find the Bane in the neighborhood. Seedoi, he's very much safe underneath his own tower. And got some extra money now also coming in with the death of the tier 1 tower in the bottom lane. More TPs arrive. Skywrath Mage on the top. Still no Mystic Flare. But this is the lane that's meant to be the aggro tri-lane. The aggro tri-lane that gets kills. That's the goal of this. Patch will also grab himself a DD rune. Which is nice for him. He's got extra mana. Trigger it. Now they can see him. They can see him coming up. He activates the DD rune, and they're going to try and kill it. There's a Fiend Script straight away. The Link is already going off from Seedoi. So he's actually, even though he loses the Bane right now, pulls out a nice amount of damage, but okay, Moonlight Shadow doesn't protect him enough. So maybe not the greatest thing in the world to move the Bane around the corner. The arrow. Oh, Skywrath. That's a good 5 seconds. But they're not coming out. That's all five heroes are on the top lane, and they're missing their crop. She's currently in middle lane and will be taking a tier 1 tower presently. Building into that Yule Scepter as well. They're picking out and saying, yo guys, we're losing our mid, we don't have fortification. The TP came back from the Pudge. Oh, that's actually maybe not the greatest idea. Stick charge and bottle charges are still there, but now he has enough damage. Pudge gets the kills. Now up on top lane. BZZ turning around for the fight. He's got Starfall already used. It has to leap himself away, but steal up from the orb damage. It's enough to kill him off with the Amplify. The Yol with the Brain Step kills off the Bane. They're getting rid of the Tombstone, so now they can go into the Jakiro. He's got Dual Breath, but they have to turn in to actually trigger it off. It's 3 points up in it, but there's 14 one charges over on Yol. Doesn't have to use it though. Only if someone was coming close enough that he could kill him. While Jotun was making sure everyone else would survive. But still, good quick rotations out from the Pudge, gets the kills. Probably was wishing he had the urn on him before all that happened. He's not lucky to have that swing, so, Yol. He lost the aggro with the creep at the last point. I thought the creep was going to cancel his long-standing clarity. But I decided just to head back and accept the fact that it was dead. So Exorcism in 45 seconds. When he has that off cooldown, this will be the mid tower. They could force it a little bit earlier if they can get an arrow across the side, but there is a Radiant Observer Ward that's watching the line. So they'll see the arrow coming from a very long way away. But Yol at the same time, all he needs is a Fiend's Grip here, and he knows it. Like if, okay, maybe not, maybe not. Way! Walk back into it. Nightmare's over on the Pudge, but he walked into that hook. Judo, you're a long way up here, man. 3 point Starfall, there's no extra detection. Ink's moving forward again. Hooks down an extra creep. And now Sidoi comes in too. Quick arrow, plasma field, Starfall. Not enough damage to kill off an already farmed up Pudge. It's a level 9 Pudge. Actually, doesn't have any point up to the Flesh Heap either, though. But Chikiro TPs him, and they'll defend. If Flesh Heap was... It's been a while since I've actually casted a Pudge game. I've got to be ready for these hooks. But killing off that Pudge is very, very difficult. Even though, like, he doesn't have any points up in the Flesh Heap. Bottom tower is under attack. He's still got 1,233 life points. Chikiro is also looking very healthy. Untying. Radiant's bottom tower is under attack. Wait, he just got a DK on three heroes. They're still hit. Still he'll go down. And that's going to be a tier 1 tower as well, Radiant's dropping with him. 5 second arrow is done. You knew what was going to come from that one. And looks like they're going to go over towards Roshan. Exorcism is off cooldown. Jotun can keep everybody alive. We've got an urn charge up his sleeve just in case. But they just want to get the Aegis, the Immortal, and the advantage from Roshan's death. Gold and experience. Also, God, smart not to move away from the side shop just then. Because if he did, BZC's arrow would never have connected. So top lane, we've got defense. The tower's actually going to tick out from Liquid Fire. So not successfully defended by Sidoi. But if he didn't TP in there, it would have been really flat that something was going on. But it's already happened, so Roshan's dead. Aegis Immortal into the hands of God. He'll have his Yule Scepter as well shortly. Even gets a DD rune inside the bottle. With no Crypt Swarm, with no Exorcism, he can't force the bottom tower. But he can definitely get some attention of Oscillate Gaming down here. And a smoke movement coming out from the Bay Mirana, and, well, Jotun doesn't have it. But they might be able to set up for something here in the middle. They got perfect vision over on VS and Skywrath. Vayne comes in, Nightmare, arrow flies well astray from BZZ. But the plasma field damage with the Fiend's Grip over on the VS, it's going to be enough to get the kill. They got the Skywrath as well as the VS, and now they're going, way! It's a lot of damage with the Brain Sap to kill off that, that retreating Chikiro. Death Prophet will take that one too. And Bane, okay, if he can get this Nightmare right now, which he can. The hook comes in, arrow will be the setup, he's already being rotted. Silence as well, so we can't even turn it off. That's a triple kill for God. No Exorcism, but he's still got the Aegis, the Immortal, and just turned on the DD rune. That's where this bonus damage is coming from. So if any of these heroes get caught in Nightmare Arrow again, they'll just die straight away. But at the same time, VP don't want to... Actually, no, they can. 10 seconds till Exorcism. The Yule Scepter will fly out once the Courier gets all the way back to base. And the mech will also be coming with Sidoi. So we have mech and Yule Scepter. Nightmare over on the side. It's over on the Skywrath Mage. Extra silence is coming in. And Sidoi just turns on the Eye of the Storm. That's enough to kill up the Skywrath Mage. Meanwhile, back in towards the middle. More earned damage. Pulling out a little... Actually, he got no damage whatsoever off him. But the shield from Jotun is able to break him free. Way! Hook down the plasma field. Yes! 47 life points. Jotun came in to try and help out. But ends up just getting caught in an ice path. And Pudge, hook shot it again. Nope. They ran every other way but that. Well, actually, technically, BZC did run that way, but he was gone a long time ago. Yeah, but there's the Yule Scepter in for God. So he's got a lot more survivability. And he'll look towards the top tower now. But they harass the tier 2 tower down. It's low, so that's okay for them. Bottom tower also taking some harassment. So if they do take a big team fight, next system is still up. They should be able to melt through the tier 2 towers on the mid and the bottom. But the next focus should definitely be the tier 1 tower up on the top lane. And also gaming, their next focus, it should be looking at getting a lot more kills. Judo still doesn't have this mech up and running. VS does have level 6, but it's really in the hands of Pudge to set up for this. He's got a level 4 Hawk, a level 2 Dismember, starting up the points up in Flesh Heap, so he's a lot more tanky. The Observer Wards are down. There's a creep currently blocking his hook shot into the Razor. He needs that creep gone. Either that or he tries to latch Jotun. Do they have a vision across the side there? No. There's no vision on the high ground. While I was looking for that, it looks like one dire Observer Ward inside the Radiant Jungle has got the death of the Skywrath Mage to happen. And also, like, I mean, they got to come and, like, if they can trade Tier 1 for Tier 2 if they want to. But no VP. Oh, they're going to flank him. Right in from behind, the Observer Ward will see it. They Moonlight Shadow, and then God just triggers the ultimate. With the Haste Rune as well, they drop Sentry Ward so they can see him. But Judo's still going to take a lot of damage. He's triggered off the Buckler trying to help out his teammates. While, well, Nightmare from the Bane, the Mage Charge trying to keep him alive. The Rot is actually a lot of damage here. But the Chikiro's gone down. The Tombstone's going to cause him some problems. But then again, not when that ultimate is up. The Exorcism doing its work. The Yule Scepter being used so they get close in on Vic Numb. And with Brain Sap, Crypt Swarm, as well as a short range Exorcism, they take the kill on the Undying and the Chikiro. The advantage now pushing 11,000, as well as almost 8k. They're going to try and force out the mid. Ink is trying to hope that this Observer Ward will get him a hero who walks up this direction. So he just needs to land the meat hook and he's good to go. Not the hook shot. Silence on the VS, you can expect it. Yep. Hook. Off target. Nightmare, where's your arrow? Actually flying down, looking for the Jakira, but it ends up hitting a creep wave instead. But the VS, oh, look at the Soul Rip. Nice damage, but the Plasma Field is just still too much. Liquid Fire did some good work too. Another stray meat hook by Ink. And the tier 2 tower will now drop in the mid lane. Remember, even if they do kill off God right now, he took at the Aegis Maul and he got a 4-man silence with the Starfall damage and the Crypt Swarm Plasma Field. It's a triple kill for Seedoy. They kill off another Tombstone. And the Exorcism, okay, it's 24 seconds. They're bottling up. In 20 seconds, they'll be able to go for this. Hey! Get over here, Seedoy. They send him up with the Yule Scepter. And Ink's a very sad man. He's still rotting himself out because he's silenced for the moment. But it's Obi-Wan Bananan that gets to go down. The VS getting caught out. And at 17 minutes in, they push high ground. They have Arcane Brutes or something. Crypt Swarm's off cooldown and he's short of the mana. But with the Ring of Basilius there, now he can let it rip. Hookshot again. Down towards the bait. Nightmares himself, protects himself from the Mystic Flare. Then the shields from Jotun, also keeping Yol alive. And Seedoy is trying to take that damage away from the Pudge. 56 points of it. But the Death Prophet Oldie's doing some work. Again, hookshot on Yol. But he brain saps also. And Seedoy, okay, you're in very, very deep here, man. He's looking for the last hit in the Pudge. Not going to work. While the middle lane, they're focusing on the range racks. Another hookshot down. No ultimate this time here from Jotun, but the arrow will connect. There's a suicide coming out from the Pudge, so they rotted himself down. They're still going to finish this range racks. God, one more attack. There she goes. He knows he's still at Aegis the Immortal. That's why he's standing his ground. Might ask for BZT to give him a lending arrow. Nah, he's going to Moonlight Shadow it. Now, God comes up. Unfortunately, the way Moonlight Shadow works is if you trigger it when a hero is dead, they're not affected by the Moonlight Shadow. I don't know if you're thinking you'll get the fade time while God is dead, but it doesn't work that way. He's almost finished a Bloodstone. Yeah, it's 19 minutes in almost, and we have Yule Scepter and almost a fully completed Bloodstone on a Death Prophet. Suppose after you've taken a Range Rax, as well as, what was that, two Tier 1s and a Tier 2 and a Tier 3? That's a good money. It really is just the fact that he just took every bit of farm he needed. 90 CS on this guy. Razor is not far behind him. The Mirana is the next one at 58. And only then do you manage to hit Oslik. But look at that. Look at even the net worth. The Skywrath Mage has more. Oh, y'all. Nightmare. He can just Fiendscript this. The Urn Charge is ticking him, though. They need some extra heal, and that's why Jotun was running in. So they ensured the kill on the Pudge. Try to go for a solo kill. This allows Yol to also afford up a Blink Dagger. At least the Jakira finishes the mech 19 minutes into this game. It's a little bit too late. They needed it for those earlier fights. But Chikira just couldn't get the farm required. So when you look at the difference between this Chikiro and the Chikiro we saw from VP, the Chikiro tried to run an aggro tri-lane. So it wasn't safe farm with, like, forcing rotations out from the enemy, which is what we saw coming out from BZZ's Chikiro in the last game. He's put the liquid fire in the bottom tower, and then the Dire Side's sitting there going, I need to get myself in here and do something, or else we're just going to keep losing map control. Hello, do something. Middle lane, Nightmare over on the Chikiro. The Tombstone is dropped down again. And what the hell is he static linking? What is that static link on? I got a feeling it was on the Chikiro on the high ground. That it was glitching like it was on the low ground. Still 224 points of damage stolen now. That's nice. Well, it's not nice. He's about to lose it. Yol, high ground, Nightmare. Oh, is he going to? He can see too many here. He's going to Nightmare himself. But he just gets evaporated out. Mesito is in here on the front lines. And they just go for Big Num. Way! Hook shot down. That'll pull him out of range. But then Jotam shields up. Force starved himself down so he was in range for this. And now God comes in. The silence over on the punch again. Forcing him to run himself out. Well, the plasma field did its work to kill off the Undying. TP out by the VS. They can't stop it. Arrow was currently on cooldown, they had no other stuns available. But at the same time, there's still 10 Bloodstone charges into God. That's a fresh Bloodstone with already 10 charges on it now. Bottom tower is under attack. And they'll push to take the tier 2 tower in the bottom lane. Easy work coming out from VP. Radiant's full Aghanims as well from Cedo. He couldn't have come at a better time. As they look to breach in, they can push the lane in through bottom and then just rotate into mid if they want to. Or they can try and take the tier 3 tower with a fresh Aghanim Scepter Eye of the Storm. And it looks like the tier 3 tower is the goal. The mid lane's already got its own momentum. It's like Chikiro's actually getting away from Yol too. And actually Yol's gonna get himself down here. Nice double ice path. No exorcism, 5 seconds on cooldown for this one at the moment. Seedoid tanking up most of that Undying. But then again, the Tombstone's now again being sniped off. The Bane is here. The hook shot down. Leap away to safety, however. The Nightmare goes over on the Undying. So no more decays for this fight at least. Fiend's grip over on the Chikiro and Yol so far away. And they can't do anything to stop him. And God's coming in so deep right now. It's gonna be careful. Well, then again, maybe they don't care about it. Nice hookshot. I stopped the brain sap, but already Skywrath Mage has had too many on him. And the star falling from BZZ. This is GG. They're inside the base, and they're fountain farming OSG. I say fountain farming, they just got him on the way back out. And yeah, Big Num would call it. Game was good. The game is GG. They went for some fun picks at least. They went for the Pudge. They gave it a shot. They tried to run the Chikiro themselves. Unsuccessful, so OSG will drop themselves down to the lower part of the bracket. And VP will play up against Team Empire in 2 days' time when the winner's bracket semi-finals will be played out. For all the details for the competition, head yourself over to msibeatit.com. The details for the competition are there. And of course, you can always check out the details at joindodo.com as well. We have our own grids and such over there. And of course, keep yourself peeled to this channel. We're back again live at 13 CEST, which is roughly 10 hours away? More than that. No. Yeah, it's like 16 hours away. Then we're live. We're back for I-League qualifiers tomorrow. Team Tinker has a couple of matches, I believe, in that one too. And then we'll also have Team Tinker play their official games in the games during the night. You'll have Dota Capitalist bringing your broadcast tomorrow, as I will have a much-needed day of rest after our very big weekend. Hope you've been enjoying all the coverage. There's a lot of VODs over on youtube.com/joindedo for you to watch, because we've been covering so much of late, and it's going to get even better as time goes on. So yeah, stay tuned to the live channel if you want to watch for the rebroadcast, but of course subscribe to the channel, follow the channel so you get notifications as well when we go live, and we're going to have special giveaways as well to people who do subscribe to the channel. More details about that will be released soon, so stay tuned for all those information. For now, thanks for watching, everyone. Have a great night, and I'll see you next time on the live stream.